गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वी आर स्टडिंग द चैप्टर ग्रेविटेशन इन विच वी हैव स्टडी दैट एवरी ऑब्जेक्ट इन द यूनिवर्स अट्रैक्ट ईच अदर विद अ फोर्स विच इज कॉल्ड द ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स. इट्स वेरी कॉमन एग्जाम्पल वैन वी सी द ऑल द ऑब्जेक्ट्स आर इफ यू ड्रॉप ऑब्जेक्ट फ्रॉम पर्टिकुलर हाइट इट ऑलवेज मूव टूवर्ड्स द अर्थ. इट मीन्स देर इज सम फोर्स विच इज एक्सर्टेड इन बिटवीन द अर्थ एंड द ऑब्जेक्ट. So this is called the gravitational force. Not only the earth and the object have this type of force, but every object in this universe having some attraction force like this. These two pins, this one and this one, they both having some attraction force between them, which is called the gravitational force. And this force which act between the two objects is directly proportional to the product of their masses. That is, if we increase the mass of the bodies, the force will also increases. So that's why we are able to see the attraction force between the earth and the object, since the earth has a very huge mass, but these two pins have a very less mass, so that we are not able to find out. We are not able to see the attraction force between these two pins. So first, it depends on the product of the mass of their mass of the bodies. Second one, it's inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. If the two objects having the mass m1 m2 are placed at a distance of d, then according to the universal law of gravitation, we can say that F directly proportional to m1 and m2, that is it is directly proportional to the product of the masses. What is the F? F is the attraction force between two objects, and it is inversely proportional to the distance, the square of the distance between them. So by combining these two equations, we will get F directly proportional to m1 m2 upon d square, and by removing this sign we get a constant, that is g. What is g? G is called the universal gravitational constant. Okay, and if you want to find how much the velocity, how much the forces changes if we change the mass of the object, if we change the distance of the object, so I explained you in last lecture how can we find out the change in force if we change the mass of the object, either we change the distance between them. So let's continue this part. What is the universal gravitational constant? We know that if the mass of the two bodies is 1 kg and we kept the these object at the distance of 1 meter to each other, then the force acting between them should be equal to g, because according to formula, g should be equal to F into d square upon m1 m2. By cross multiplication, we get this value of g. So by keeping the value of d1 and m1 is 1 and m2 is 1, we get g is equal to F, like this. So it means, in case if we keep two objects at a distance of 1 meter having the mass of 1 kg each, then the force of attraction acting between them is equal to always g. And by experiment, we find that the value of this g is equal to 6.67 10 to the power minus 11 newton meter square per kg square. So this is exact value of g, which is constant in all universe. It do not changes anywhere. It means it is same on this earth, even on the moon, even on the sun or the other planets or the stars. The value of g is always constant. So that's why it is called the universal gravitational constant. Okay, and about the unit of this g, since the force having the unit newton and the distance between them is having the unit of meter, this is the SI unit of distance, and the mass having the unit of kg. So we get the SI unit of g, universal gravitational constant, that is newton meter square per kg square. So we have studied all these things in last video. Now I am going to explain you some numerical of this chapter, which is based on the universal law of gravitation. So I am taking one example. This is a numerical question. They calculate the force of gravitation. You have to calculate the force of gravitation. So I am writing it like, we have to find the value of F due to the earth on a ball. Okay. So it means we have to find the force of attraction between the earth and the ball. So here is the earth and this is a ball. Ball of mass 1 kg. So the mass of the ball, I am writing it like m1. The mass of the ball is 1 kg. Lying on the ground, lying on the surface of the earth. So we place the ball on the surface of the earth, it will it there will be some attraction force between them, which we call the gravitational force. So for finding it, we can use the formula, that is F is equal to g m1 m2 upon d square. So for this we should know the value of mass of both the objects and the distance between them. So here in case, if you place the object on this earth, first the mass of the object is 1 kg and m2 is the mass of the earth. So the mass of the earth in the question is 6 × 10⁻²⁴ kg. Okay, in question you have the mass of the ball and the mass of the earth and the radius of the earth. You know the distance between the object and the earth is equal to the radius of the earth. You can find out the distance between them by finding the distance between the center of their center of the objects. It means if we combine, if we join the center of one object with the other object, it means if we combine the centers of both the object, this is the actual distance between them. So in case earth and the ball, since the ball having a very less radius as compared to the earth, so we can say the distance, the radius of the earth is equal to the distance between the earth and the ball. Again, I am telling you, the distance between the earth and the ball is equal to the radius of the earth. Since the ball has a very small radius, so we can say the radius of the earth is equal to the distance between the ball and the earth. So I am writing it like DE. E represent for the earth. So D means the distance between the object and the earth is, where D is the radius of the earth, is equal to 6.4 × 10³ kilometer. Now this is given in question. These all values are given in the question, but main important thing is we know that the distance having the SI unit of meter. So we will have to convert this kilometer into meter by multiplying it by 1000. We will get 6.4 × 10⁶ meter. So it means this is the radius of the earth. And we know the value of G. In question it is given that 6.7 × 10⁻¹¹. The value of G is 6.67, but for easy calculation it was given that 6.67 × 10⁻¹¹ is the value of G. Newton meter square per kg square. We should always write the unit along with the values. So these are the values given in the question. You have to find the value of force between them. So we know the formula according to the universal law of gravitation. We know that F is equal to G m1 m2 upon d square, where g is 6.7 × 10⁻¹⁻ into m1 is 1 kg and m2 is 6 × 10⁻¹⁴ divided by d means this is 6.4 × 10⁻¹⁶ in meter square. Okay, so what we have done, we put only the values of different symbols. Now for easy calculation, what can we do? For easy calculation, we will take the numerical value along a side and the powers, the 10⁻⁶ something in a side. Like we know that what was the value of, okay, let me check, 6.7. So I am taking all the figures together, 6.7 × 6 divided by 6.4 square, okay, and 10⁻¹⁰ and the values of 10⁻⁰ together, like 10⁻¹⁰ into 10⁻²⁴ upon 10⁻⁶ square. So for easy calculation, what will you do? You will calculate these value and these values together. For 10⁻⁰, we know that in multiplication powers add in, and in division we separate the powers. So we get the 10⁻⁶ − 11 + 24 − 12. So here it will be −23. It means only 10 will be remaining here. And by calculating these value, you will get approx the value that is equal to the 0.98 by calculation. How will you calculate it? If it is easy to cancel, then you can cancel out these values like 2, 3s are 6, 3.2. And after that, if it's not possible to cut down the values, then please multiply the numerator and denominator and then actual divide. So we get the value 0.98 into 10 is equal to 9.8 Newton. Newton is the SI unit of force. So we can find the value of force by putting all the values together. Like one more example, one more question. The mass of the earth. In the question, the mass of the earth is given. So I am writing it like M1. You can also write it like ME. ME means the mass of the earth. It is given that it is equal to 6 into 10 power 24 kg. And that of the moon. And the mass of the moon, M2, is equal to 7.4 into 10 power 22 kg. So it is given in the question. If the distance between the earth and the moon is, so the distance between the earth and the moon, you know, this is earth and this is moon. The distance between them is, the distance between the center of them is, so I am writing it like D, is equal to 3.84 into 10 power 5 kilometer. Again, it is in kilometer. And we know that we should always put the value of D, distance, in meter. So we will multiply it by 1000. We will get it. Into 10 power 8 meter. We will get the value this. Okay, the distance between the earth and the moon is this one. Calculate the force exerted by the earth on the moon. Here, the value of G is also equal to 6.7 into 10 power minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. So, these are the value in the question. So, first for every numerical of physics, you should write the values which we have, which we get from the question like this. Now, since you want to find the value of F, you know the formula for the F is equal to G, M1, M2 upon D square. Then put the values here. G is 6.7 into 10 power minus 11 into M1 is 6 into 10 power 24. M2 is 7.4 into 10 power 22 divided by D square. D square means 3.84 into 10 power 8 whole square. Now again, the same method we use for calculating it, like 6.7 into numerical value along a side upon 3.84 into 3.84. So first you will cut the values which can be cancelled out with the same number, like we can cut these values by 2 and this one also by 2. So after when it's not possible to cut down the values in numerator and denominator, then simply multiply the numerator and then denominator and then actual divide and put the tens power something along a side. It means ek jaisi values ko aapko ek saath rakhna hai. So after multiplication you will get something value like 2.01 into tens power here we will add this value 22 minus 11. It will be 11 plus ka. और फिर आप लेके जाएंगे माइनस 16. ओके आई थिंक आई फॉरगेट टू राइट द वैल्यू ऑफ 10 पावर 24. यस सो 24 प्लस 22 इट इज इक्वल टू 46 माइनस 11. इट विल बी 46 माइनस 11 विल बी 35. 46 माइनस 11 यस इट विल बी 35 एंड देन माइनस 16. So you will get 35 minus 16, you will get 35 minus 16 will be 19. Okay. So here after multiplication you will get the values 20.1 into 10 power 20. How much? 19. Okay, sorry, 19 we get. Or we can say that we can put the decimal here. In scientific notation, we have to write all the physical quantities like this. कि डेसिमल को हमेशा एक नंबर के बाद रखना होता है. तो 2.01 इंटू 10 पावर 20. दिस इज द फोर्स एक्सर्टेड बिटवीन द ऑब्जेक्ट्स. सो दीज आर सम सिंपल न्यूमेरिकल हैविंग लॉट ऑफ कैलकुलेशन ऑफ दिस यूनिवर्सल ऑफ ग्रेविटेशन विच इज रिलेटेड टू द यूनिवर्सल ऑफ ग्रेविटेशन. नाउ व्हाट इज द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ दिस ग्रेविटेशन, ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स? व्हाट आर द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स? इम्पॉर्टेंस of gravitational force. So what are the importance of this force? So you know, in solar system all the planets revolve around the sun. How is it possible all the planets revolve around the sun? It's possible due to the attraction force acting between the sun and the planets. So this is a gravitational force which is active between the sun and the planet, which make the planet revolve around the sun. So this is one of the application, one is the importance of universal gravitation, gravitational force. That is, the planets revolve around the sun, or we can say the solar system exists due to the gravitational force. This solar system exists due to the gravitational force, because this is a gravitational force which make the planets revolve around the sun. Okay, so this is the one importance. So only, not only this importance is, this is not only the importance of gravitational force. Also we know that in geography we learned about the tides, high tides and low tides. You know how it's possible to come to high tide, what is the reason behind the tides in the sea? So in case of high tide means when the water level is increases in a seawater. How it happens actually, this is a earth and this is a seawater. So what happened at the time of high tide? Suppose this is a moon. This can be a moon or this can be a sun. So by the attraction force of this moon, this seawater come towards the moon like this. So that's why its level increases towards this. Suppose the water level, आपने कभी देखा भी हो तो क्या होता है कि जिस टाइम समुद्र एक टाइम बहुत पीछे रहता है, सपोज पहले यहाँ पे है, फिर जब हाई टाइड्स होता है तो समुद्र का पानी बहुत आगे तक आ जाता है. सो इज इट पॉसिबल ड्यू टू द ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स विच इज एक्टिंग बिटवीन द मून एंड द सी वाटर, इवन दो दिस ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स ऑल्सो एक्टिंग बिटवीन द सन एंड द सी वाटर. सो डेट्स वाई द हाई टाइड्स अकर. And in the case of low tides, when there is no moon or sun to attract these seawater, so there is a case of low tides. So the tides in a seawater is formed due to the gravitational force acting between them. So there is a lots of applications of the application of the gravitational force. Now I am going to explain you Kepler's law of planetary movement. Kepler was a scientist who gave his three laws of planetary movement. We know that all the planets move around a planetary movement. So all the planets are moving around the sun. So Kepler explained ki what are the three laws which all the planets follow for revolving around the sun. So Kepler's the full name of the Kepler's is Johannes Kepler. So he gave the law related to the planetary motion. According to first law, the planet move in elliptical orbits. Elliptical orbit. You know what is the meaning of elliptical? Elliptical means which is not particular, which is not perfect circular orbits. Like this shape is circular, and if we make it like this, this is called the elliptical orbit. So the planet move in elliptical orbits around the sun. With sun at one of the two foci of elliptical orbit. So what is the meaning of this law? It means this is the elliptical orbit in which a planet is revolving around the sun. So according to this law, The sun can be present at one of the two focus. Actually, an elliptical orbit has two focus, this one or this one. So an elliptical orbit, since it has two focus, so according to the Kepler's first law, the planet revolves around the sun such that the sun is present one of the foci. Okay, the sun can be here or it can be here. So a planet revolves around a elliptical orbit around the sun, in which the sun is at one of the foci of elliptical orbit. So this is the first law of Kepler. Now according to the second law of Kepler. This is first law of Kepler. I am going to explain you the second law of Kepler, Kepler's second law. So according to Kepler's second law, each planet revolves around the sun in such a way that the line joining the line joining the planet to the sun sweeps over equal areas in equal interval of time. So I'm going to explain you what is the meaning of this law, intervals of time. It means, suppose this is the elliptical orbit in which a planet revolving around the sun, and this is the sun. So according to Kepler's second law, if a planet is here far from sun, then the area covered by this planet, suppose it cover this distance in 1 hour. So in 1 hour, the area covered by this planet is this one. And suppose now the planet move after revolving, after moving certain distance, it comes to here, near to the sun. Then in 1 hour, he moves such a distance so that the area covered by this planet is now equal to the area covered by this part. It means, it is written that each planet revolves around the sun in such a way that line joining the planet to the sun sweeps equal area in equal interval of time. It means in equal interval of time, the area covered by the planet will be equal. If we join the sun to the planet, the area covered by the planet should be equal in equal interval of time. Suppose in 1 hour, if we cover this distance, this area, it means a small distance, then if it come near to the sun, it has to cover the last distance so that the area covered by it should be equal to this one. So you can say that if the planet is near to the sun, it moves with a high speed, and when it is farther from the sun, it moves with a slow speed. So this is the second law, Kepler's second law. Now the third law. According to Kepler's third law, a planet does not move. A planet does not move with constant speed around the sun. This was the same second law. I'm going to explain you now third law. This is the third law. So according to third law, the cube of the mean distance of a planet from the sun is directly proportional to the square of time it takes to move around the sun. Okay, what is the meaning of this statement? The cube of the mean distance of the planet from the sun. Mean distance means this is sun. So we can't say what is the exact distance between the planet and the sun, because here the distance is large and here in this case the distance is less. So actually what we done? We find out the average of the distance of the planet from the sun. See, according to this law, the average distance, suppose we are representing it by R. R is the radius of the, we can say that R should be the radius of the circle. So in case we are taking the radius of this elliptical orbit, this is the average radius. So according to this law, the cube of the mean distance of the planet from the sun, it means the cube of this distance. Suppose the mean of the distance of the planet and the sun is R. So the cube of this distance is directly proportional, it is directly proportional to the square of the time it takes to move around the sun. Is suppose this planet takes T hours to move around this sun. So according to this law, it is equal to the T square. R cube is directly proportional to the T square. What is R here? R is the average distance between the Earth, the planet and the sun. And what is the T? T is the time taken by the planet to move around the sun. So this is the Kepler's third law. Or we can write it like R cubed is equal to a constant. We know that we always remove this sign by taking some constant here. Constant into T square. Or we can say R cube upon T square is equal to a constant. So this is Kepler's third law. Now what we have studied now? We have studied about the universal law of gravitation. Then we study about the some numerical portion of this chapter. I know the numerical is not so difficult, it's so easy, but it has a lots of calculation. Yeah. And we have studied about the Kepler's law. So according to first law, the planets move in elliptical orbit and in which the sun is found at the one of the foci. According to second law, the planets move around the sun in such a way that the area covered by the planet is equal in equal interval of time. It means if a planet is far from the sun, it moves with a slow speed, and when it comes near to the sun, it moves with a high speed, so that the area swept by this planet is always equal. And according to the third law, we studied that the distance of the planet from the sun, we represented by R, we call it like average distance. So the cube of the average distance of the planet and the sun is directly proportional to the time taken by this planet to move around the sun. The square of the time taken by the planet to move around the sun. So these are the three laws we have studied in this part. Now, from my side, there is a question for you. The question is, since we know that all the objects are having some attraction force between them, according to universal law of gravitation, we know that every object attracts every other object with certain force. So this is a planet, this is a Earth, and this is a apple. And we know that when it falls from a tree, what happens? It always falls on the Earth. If both of them having same attraction force, we know the attraction force is equal to the G M1 M2 upon R square, where G is the constant, M1 is the mass of the apple, and M2 is the mass of the Earth, and D is the distance of the Earth and the apple. It's always equal for both the object, for the Earth as well as the apple. Then why always apple move
drop on the earth. Why this earth do not drop on this apple? If both of them having the same attraction force, then it should always fall. It should always be possible that this earth falls on the apple. But it doesn't happen. Why it's happened that always earth apple moves towards the earth? Why this earth do not move towards the apple, though they have the same attraction force between them? So this is the question from my side. Now I'm going to explain you free fall means if we drop something from certain height on the earth, what happened? We know that it always moves towards the earth. If a object is moved towards the earth in which the earth exerts some attraction force on the object, so this type of motion in which no other force is acting on the object, only the gravitational force, due to this gravitational force the object is moved towards the earth. This type of motion of the object in which the object moves towards the earth under the gravity of this earth is called the free fall. So we can define the free fall like this: the falling of the body, the falling of a body from a height towards the earth under the gravitational force of earth is called free fall. So free fall means when something is fall towards the earth under the gravitational force which is exerted by the earth, under the gravity of the earth. This is called free fall. So just imagine if we are in a lift and due to some reason the rope of the lift break. What will happen? You will move towards the earth with a greater speed. This is called the free fall. So, okay, this was about the free fall. And in next video, we will understand what is the acceleration which is produced in the body when it is freely fall on the earth. Is it constant for every object or is it depend on the mass of the object? So in next video, we will understand what is the meaning of what is the acceleration through gravity. It means what is the acceleration produced by the earth on the body which is moving towards it, and how can we calculate this value. So now aaj yahi khatam karte hain aur next video mein hum samjhenge iske aage ka part. Okay, bye.